I'd like to invite, and I would appreciate if our August house could raise a warm applause for Nandita Haskar. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us. Let me invite our second guest. Can I have Harsh Mander? He's a former IAS officer, a writer, a social activist. Thank you, Mr. Mander. Kanak Mani Dixit, a writer, a journalist, an activist from Nepal. Thank you. Harsh, let's begin with you. What does speak truth to power mean to you?
There are moments in history, in the history of any country, when the most radical, revolutionary public service that you can do is to speak the truth. And I think that particularly we are living at one such moment in India's history where whatever else you do, the importance of speaking truth and speaking truth fearlessly, whatever happens, has become very important but also very difficult. And just a little bit about why I feel this moment has become so difficult. On the one hand, we're seeing, particularly after this, the second election of this government, at a time when the economy is in such bad shape, where there was very little else on offer truly this time, unlike in 2014, where there was an expectation of jobs, of improvement of the economy, this time what was really on offer was muscular, nationalist, Hindutva, oriented hate, and the fact that the government got an even larger backing this time, I feel that they're acting as though they have a clear mandate now to implement the idea of the Hindu Rashtra. And they have identified three major enemies. One, I would say the first enemy is the morality of the constitution. Not just the letter of the constitution, but that it stood for a country which belonged equally to people of every faith and identity. It was a country where justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, etc. The second enemy is the Indian Muslim. And there is an open declaration of war in many ways. So, you know, and over the next couple of years, we're going to see, we've seen 370, we're going to see the Ayodhya temple, we're going to see the Citizenship Amendment Act, which will actually alter India's secular constitution, which means only Muslims within India will have to prove their citizenship on the basis of documents, everybody else is okay, and a national NRC, and so on. So that is, and the third enemy is those who stand in defense of the constitution and of India's religious minorities, and which is the dissenter or the voices of conscience. And I see much more clearly than in the last 5 years an all-out assault on all of these three. And in these times, therefore, speaking truth to power at all costs becomes our highest duty.
You know, we also have Kanak, you know, Harsh, you said that this is possibly in India, but I would reckon, you know, there is a thought which suggests that there is a rise of majoritarian politics across the country, across the world. And Kanak comes from Nepal, and you yourself, you know, you've been arrested, your paper has been shut down, it's restarted now. How would you read speaking truth to power in the current context?
Well, I would like to bring the South Asian perspective, coming myself from Kathmandu. And I would like to say that one looks at India askance for how much it is becoming more like the rest of South Asia. That is a major danger that everybody has thought of India as the exemplar for democracy, for freedom of expression, freedom of assembly, all the fundamental rights. And while India may have made mistakes along the way, the ideal was always to be emulated. Mm-hmm. And that is where I believe India has slipped. As a result, the topic of the day being speaking truth to power, looking at each of our societies, each of our societies is extremely weakened. But the society that we thought would stand firm was India. That's why, responding to your question, I would say speaking truth to power is more and more difficult all over South Asia. There is self-censorship because of intimidation of the opinion makers and journalists all over South Asia. There is social media populism all over South Asia. There is state autocracy. There is majoritarian radical populism, as I call it. So for that reason, the journalists and the writers and the opinion makers are intimidated. But if I were to compare two societies, Indian opinion makers are just coming on to a challenge that the Pakistani opinion makers have had to suffer for decades. And I feel that the Indian intelligentsia and the Nepali intelligentsia, the Bangladeshi intelligentsia, would do well to look at how have the Urdu-speaking independent opinion makers of Pakistan survived all these years. What is the strength they take? What is the courage? What is the fount of their courage? I believe that rather than be insular, and I'm responding to your question directly looking at India, I would say look at surrounding societies and don't go the way they have.
So you think we're treading on that precipice of going the Pakistan route?
I think speaking specifically right now to the topic of media self-censorship, because when you are not able to speak truth to power, which you should, then you are self-censoring. I believe self-censorship is rampant in India today. I can look at it from my perspective from Kathmandu, looking at your television channels, the shouting match that is called a television programming, or if you look at the social media and the bile and the vitriol that is there, that immediately makes everybody go quiet.
But Kanak, there's this other side, and I'll bring Nandita in as well.
Sure.
You know, the fact that we're sitting here, all three of us, debating what we are, it really isn't that bleak, is it?
Your question?
No, you can answer that, and I'll bring in Nandita as well.
Well, you see, one can look for a silver lining and say it's probably not as bleak, but the direction is so clear, and the dangers that it is leading towards us, not only in India, but all over South Asia, because what happens in India impacts the rest of South Asia as well. And India itself is big enough. I would say that there is no point of being complacent, saying maybe it is not as bad as it is. I can tell you from my perspective, from outside India, it looks pretty bad.
All right, okay. So let me bring in Nandita right now. You know, Nandita, you wrote a book, I wasn't quite around then, but my mother talks about how some of you took to the streets in 1984. We are marking the 35th anniversary of the anti-Sikh riots. You wrote a book called The Delhi Riots, 3 Days in the Life of a Nation. At that point of time, you went on to elucidate what had happened. And I believe Mr. Harsh Mander had also gone out and supported you, saying that, whatever your book, you co-wrote a book, I think, with somebody, Uma Chakravarti. And he said that what you wrote was true. I just want to, maybe for you to bring in context of, was it easier speaking truth to power then to now? Can you bring that comparison out?
Well, I think it's time to be honest.
Okay.
So yes, it was easier in a sense because as human rights lawyers and as human rights activists, there was some kind of space at that time. But today, the reality is far more complex. And I think that what Kanak Dixit is saying is, to me, very important. I just want, for the sake of our discussion, speaking truth to power means to confront those in important positions. It's not only government or state. Whether in government, business, or religious institutions, to speak truth to power means to demand a moral response to a problem, either on and not to have an expedient, easy, selfish response. In my understanding, and I'm speaking from my experience with the activists, because you said, I find it very difficult among the activists who are speaking out today. There were far more activists in 84 who spoke out than they are today. So, and I think that is, to me, a very serious situation, because the situation, as Harsh has outlined, in that situation, when more and more activists are silent, and they are not speaking out, not only to the government, but even to business interests, to within the media, within any area. So I think that it is a very serious situation. And the movements, whatever they were, human rights movement, women's movement, left movement, all these movements have weakened.
So because you think it was easier then?
Yeah, because to speak truth to power, it's not only an individual. We could speak truth because we had a movement behind us. We had a human rights movement. Today, if I speak truth or if I say the same things, I'm much more alone.
Why do you think it's a function of the last 5 years and not more?
I think there are many reasons for it. One is an erosion of civil society. There is a corporatization of the media. There is a, for various historical reasons, we have not reinvented our movements. The movement started in a post-emergency situation in 75. That's how we all came in. And that's it. The world has changed. And in India, I'm speaking for the human rights community for which I belong, we don't have introspection of the kind we should have. And to be able to answer the charges like someone from Nepal makes against us, we are always being defensive. You know, we are saying, no, but we have this, we have that, we have this debate. Yes, we have it. That's why I think it's very important. That's why I'm here. But is that enough?
You know, what we're going to do is we're going to continue to keep throwing it out to the audience. So anytime, you know, somebody wants to come in, interject, are you all three okay to take questions? So at any time you want to, you know, make a point or you want to ask a question, please do so. Because, you know, Harsh, I'll come back to you. You know, these are times of high polarized opinion as well. And I would reckon some of you on this dais would be judged by some of them in the audience as urban Nazis, anti-nationals. Good. It's a huge possibility. And I'm sure, you know, and that's what I want to, you know, I'll come to you. Give me 1 minute, I'll come to you, and then we'll go to Harsh first.
So I don't think India has ever been as deeply and profoundly divided since independence as it is now. The polarization that you speak about is profound. And these are not, this is not a superficial, this is not even a battle between political parties. It's a battle between two imaginations for India. So do we want an India where it does not matter which god you worship, it does not matter, you know, which caste or community or language, your gender, you're an equal citizen in every way? Or do we want a majoritarian state, which is, this idea of very European or Pakistan kind of homogenized, everybody has to be the same, everybody has to adhere. This is one thing, but this, you were talking about comparing to the past. You know, in the emergency, they had to lock up journalists in jail to silence them, and still they were not properly silenced. When the Babri Masjid was demolished, actually, when we had 25 years, and I was sitting in the press club listening, and people were recounting how journalists were thrashed, beaten up, because they were telling the truth. Today, we are seeing journalists neither locked up nor being beaten up. And still, they are so afraid to speak, just do their elementary job of speaking
just,
the truth.
Is it just my tribe? Is it just
journalists? No. In fact, I was going to say, but it's very important to talk about, traverse many, I write, I do columns, and so on, but I am a human rights worker, I'm a peace worker, and I see an enormous amount of self-censorship in civil society. I was in the civil service. In fact, in the IAS, in the academy, I taught there for 3 years, and my first lecture to young civil servants used to be that it is both your right and your duty to dissent, to speak out. That is why you're here. Your duty is not here to blindly obey. And that I used to always want to make my first lecture to them. So you're seeing the civil services, you're seeing civil society, you're seeing academia, you're seeing your tribe as well. I think that across we are seeing an extraordinary self-censorship and silence. And I can see only three reasons for silence. And you know, the audience is here. If we are silent when we are seeing this amount of injustice being mounted, Mr. Amit Shah has said that they're going to pass a Citizenship Amendment Act, which will require only Muslims to prove their citizenship. Is this a concern of Muslims or is it a concern of all of us? Do you want to live in an India which is divided in on religious lines? It's for us, especially non-Muslims, to have a sense of outrage, to speak out. I feel that we should do if they pass a Citizenship Amendment Act, if Gandhiji was here, the true act of civil disobedience would be for all of us to register Muslim in protest. If you're going to only target Muslims, I will register as Muslim and take on the wrath of the state. But we are not standing in solidarity. We don't have an outrage. We don't care. And I think that the crisis of... So silence can be for three reasons, and I'll finish there. The first reason is I don't care. I don't belong to I'm not a Muslim, I'm not a Dalit, it's not going to happen to me, so why should I care? The second reason for my silence can be that I'm frightened to speak, and there is an atmosphere, and the, you know, like NGOs, I keep speaking to them. I just this morning, there's a place I go to, and this person was telling me, you know, we can't invite you, we can't have you to speak. If you come without any kind of record and you just come here, I mean, it's extraordinary how frightened people are even to associate with you. And so there is a fear. But I think that the third reason for our silence can be that in our hearts, we actually support what is happening. We share the hate. So I have outsourced to the lynch mob my hate. I'm not going to do the hate myself, but I'm happy that it's happening. If Kashmiris are locked up for 80 days, I'm happy. That's, you know, it needed to be done. And I think that, you know, for all of us who remain silent, we have to decide, are we silent because we don't care or because we are frightened, or is it because we actually share the hatred? All of those are problematic.
All right. So, you know, I know, Kanak, you wanted to come in. Can I get a quick word in from that gentleman in the blue shirt, and then I'll just come back to you.
So don't you think the intellectuals, academy, and everyone is failed to send the message of the person in the village, because they are the person who are beneficiaries of the government schemes and all. So if we in the club discussing something and the nectar is not reaching to the people who are...
So is it the preserve of the elite, privileged lot to have conversations like this? I would reckon that's what he's trying to...
Valid point. Am I... honorary member of the Latians Club today is what I'd like to say, because I will respond to your point from my particular perspective coming from Kathmandu. But let me firstly preface my presence here in front of this audience, which I understand would be almost entirely from India, that I come from Nepal, and what right do I have to pass judgment or comment on matters of India? But that is the South Asian in me. To be a South Asian citizen and also a citizen of Nepal or India or Sri Lanka or Bangladesh or Pakistan, you should rise to the level where you can critique the other side and accept the criticism on the other side. Because to me, we're talking about values here. With that point, let me just say, one, I hope that in this session we could go towards not just describing the situation of self-censorship, but why. And in that, Harsha with his 3 points already got us started in that direction. And another point, again, as a person from Kathmandu, you notice I identify myself by my city. Best not to identify by your nationality, because you're trying to be beyond the nation state, right? Coming from Kathmandu, looking at India, I remember in the 70s and the 80s, the civil liberty unions were the stars of who held up the flame of liberty and freedom. And these days, I do not hear enough of the civil liberty unions. And now to your point, sir, about the village. At least I can give you my Kathmandu perspective. One of the problems is that the discourse at the level of where these things are discussed happen to be in the English language. In Nepal, the dichotomy between the English language elite and the vernacular does not exist really. Whatever is written at the by the super elite gentleman or woman gets to the village through the national Nepali newspapers, because the aspect of non-colonization means that Nepali language crosses the barriers. My sense in India is that the discourse of empathy, empathy for the other, this point has somewhere got stuck in the English language arena, hasn't penetrated the vernacular.
All right, so Nandita wanted to...
I don't think that's quite true, because this is true mostly for the Hindi speaking. Because the dichotomy is, because we Hindi speaking people are not bilingual. We are one lingual. We speak English. Whereas I know for my colleagues in the civil liberties movement, whether it's Bal Gopal or it is Sujato in Bengal, they all speak in their in Bengali or in Tamil or in Kannada or whatever. And so that gap is not so much there, except in the Hindi speaking world. But yes, that is, and since Hindi speaking world is such a large world, it is true that we don't get to the villages. But I would also say that, yes, civil liberty, that's what I said, the civil liberties movement to which I belonged does not exist. It's finished almost. And the villages, the what is going into the villages, the people who are there, are large, or and in urban areas, are the NGOs. Now, NGOs do not speak out in the same way as a movement does. The NGOization of the movements means that these NGOs are dependent on either foreign funding or state funding or with some other agenda. They're not accountable to the people. Whereas when we were in civil liberties, we'd be accountable to the people. So there, this is another very big area to show why we are not that vibrant civil liberties movement for which, you know, we were so proud.
You know, I see a lot of raised hands. I'm going to keep coming, the gentleman right there in the checked shirt. But I want to ask you, Nandita, one question, and that is, has something, or, you know, the order that has been set in the last 5 to 6 years, has that upset the apple cart? Because there is a majority which clearly feels so. And that is what, you know, this gentleman right there was saying, you know, till now, what was the preserve of the privileged elite or Latians? You know, terminology like that would not have come into play if it wasn't the case. And it's the lot that has been upset, and that's why this massive divide has been created.
I wouldn't put it like that. I would say, in fact, my own university, JNU, if I see, the president, Kanhaiya Kumar, speaks in Hindi, and he comes from a totally different background. So today in the university, you don't have a domination of English speaking.
Let me correct myself, the leftist privileged, or privileged.
They are left. I mean, right. Kanhaiya Kumar is from Communist Party.
Exactly.
So I don't agree with that. And but what is happening is that the youth which have come up, the Karos, who are the new voters, they are very cut. You know, my generation, and I'm 65, is the last generation which was in touch with the freedom struggle. There's a complete historical break. And the youth have not been exposed to any politics, neither the human rights movement, nor the left movement, nor all the movements of the concept of South Asia, nor of any of the various parties. So they're not exposed to any movements. They feel a sense of resentment. And this resentment comes out in various ways.
Let me take a quick question, but why so much resentment? Okay, I'll just give you an example. Why so much resentment against JNU? Why so much angst against a Kanhaiya Kumar? And that has been, you know, and there is a majoritarian view of that, where every time JNU comes up, there is a stereotype immediately which is set in somebody's mind. Why that?
Well, there are many, many reasons. As I said, the JNU, there's an image that has been built. There's a discourse. Now, for instance, the discourse said we are anti-national. Why are we anti-national? Because we are criticizing the army. Now, for me, I would just like to give an example. When I was a student of JNU, I filed the first case against the Indian Army, and my client is sitting here, he's my husband. And at that time, when I filed that case, nobody was supposed to speak about Indian Army, it was supposed to be anti-national. But having filed the case in Supreme Court, it was the first time Naga students in JNU had a meeting to say, maybe we can get justice in India. Now, is that not national? I did this with that view. I filed the case on behalf, or I fought for the parliament attack case for a man, a Kashmiri Muslim, accused of attacking the parliament. Why? Because by making sure that he, because I felt he was innocent, by taking up his case and having a national campaign and getting him acquitted, thousands and thousands of Kashmiris believed in Indian democracy.
Most Indians called you anti-national.
That is okay. But the Kashmiris felt that they were Indians who were willing to support. They were Kashmiris. The security guard, when I entered Srinagar, she gave me a hug and I thought, you know, now I'm being arrested. And she said, we want to tell you now, we feel that there are some Indians standing up for us. So there are, the definition of my India is that I want Kashmiris and Nagas to feel as much Indian and belong here. I don't want every single other person not to feel at home.
You know, we're going to talk a little more. We're going to talk about maybe the definition and, you know, the language or how rules are being rewritten around nationalism. What Kanak said, you know, we've talked about what's going on and that there is a perception that you can't speak up to power. We're discussing the whys that we can't, and hopefully we'll try and reach a solution. But let's get in as much conversation. The gentleman in the check shirt has been once. So sit and make your point. Sit. We'll get a mic to you.
You know, sir, my background is that I have been with the government for 35 years. I have been in the Aligarh Muslim University for 3 years teaching. And for last 17 years, I am outside government. Now, I feel betrayed when people talk of majoritarian. Now, for 2,000 years, what we have done? We have welcomed everybody. We being in majority, we have welcomed everybody. And now we are being accused for last 5 years or 7 years that we are having majority in. Now when Muslim, our Hindu brothers are tortured in Pakistan or in Bangladesh and we welcome them, then we say that we should welcome the Muslims also. I am not against Muslims, but point is that somebody there should be to hear our own people. Now, we are talking every time majority. What we have done as a majority, say, few incidents of lynching, these are bad. But it may happen in a population of 125 crores. I went, sir, to England in 1982, and the first incident I heard was a rape case. They have put a photograph. Now, what I say is that in a country of 125 crore population, these things might happen.
All right, sir. Okay, made your point, sir. Urge you all to just keep it a little short, and we'll talk. I'll come to everybody. So there are claps that are being generated. Yeah. So that's why when I started this conversation, there'll be a lot who would disagree with what you're saying today.
Absolutely. Okay. To my mind, exactly. In fact, what when we say we Indians, who are we talking about? Are we talking about we Hindu Indians, we upper caste Hindu Indians? We are talking about we Indians equally as we Naga Indians, we Kashmiri Indians, we Muslim Indians, we atheist Indians. And I think that what is happening in the last, you know, what is being built up is an idea that the nation is equal to the supreme leader, is equal to his government, is equal to his party, is equal to the Hindu religion. And that all of these are one. And if you criticize or have disagreements with any one of these, you are against the nation and you are against the Hindu faith. I think that is totally absurd. I love my country, which is why I will fight when there is injustice. I'm an agnostic, but if I was a Hindu or if I was a Sikh, I would be even more anguished if something is done in the name of my religion. After all, just think about who was the greatest Hindu that who has lived in India over the last 100, 200 years? There would be no doubt that it is Mahatma Gandhi. He was a practicing Hindu. And he gave his life for the rights and for an India in which Muslims would live as equal citizens in every respect. So I think that my idea of we Indians is an India that belongs equally to all. And this idea of being aggrieved, see, the upper caste Hindu dominates every walk of life and still feels aggrieved. You look at academia, you look at business, you look at every field, we dominate and yet feel aggrieved. And I just like to say again to what the young man had said there, every second Indian today is born is below the age of 25. Every second Indian has been born after the Babri Masjid demolition, after neoliberalism. They have never lived an India which was imagined differently. And I think that that is part of the crisis. And our failure of people of my generation and Nandita in India, is that we have not been able to build the kind of enthusiasm, what my brother here has spoken. There is a different imagination, which is that we are aggrieved as Hindus in this country. We are suffering and we need to correct 1,000 years, 2,000 years, etc., etc. That's one kind of discourse. Another kind of discourse is that everybody, you know, the country, the state in India which has the largest diversity is Arunachal Pradesh. There are about 60 languages. Some are spoken by just 300 people. Those 300 people, the Arunachalese tribal speaking, their language is equally an Indian. 100% in every respect, this country belongs equally to that person. We have different imaginations. We have not succeeded in persuading and exciting young people about that imagination. And the alternative imagination, which is in contradiction to India's freedom struggle and the Constitution of India, is gathering more and more support. That is our failure.
Why is it gathering more support? Kanak, you wanted to come in. Can I take
just
a question
on this
before
one.
That?
Just on this one.
Yes.
I will just humbly suggest that if you want to go 2,000 years back into history, then that is the history of what today we call South Asia. Not India, the nation state alone. It includes everybody. So 2,000 years would bring in Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh, at the very least, if you talk about the subcontinent, number one. Number two is everybody in South Asia is an arrival. Everyone is an arrival, different times of the day. After modern human, genetically modern humans, after they came out of the Rift Valley into the Levant and moved eastward, 75,000 years ago, and then again 30,000 years ago, and the most recent movements, 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 years ago, it's everybody is in it together. And I believe that those who came 2,000 years ago, supposedly to take over this space, they have become South Asians, they have become Indians. So I do not see this questioning, this thread of questioning, I frankly do not understand.
All right, let me, the gentleman at the back in the black, can we get a mic coming, and then I'll come to you and you can ask.
It'll be great if the panelists can quickly sum up where do they see this heading. So speaking truth to power is where the discussion initially started from. And we have talked more or less about what has been happening in the last 5 to 7 years, both from an Indian perspective and from Kathmandu's perspective. Like, where are we going? Are the modes of suppression going to change? Or will we continue to raise our voice against injustice? Where are we headed as a country?
Well, I'd just like to quote Chomsky for old time's sake. He said, power knows the truth already and busy concealing it. So speaking truth to power, I think we need to have an understanding that when we speak truth to power, if we are trying to speak to the state, they know this, they know it, they're trying to conceal it. So from a little bit from our discussion, and to answer your question, we need to speak the truth to each other and to understand and to reflect and to again and again understand these questions and have real conversations. Now, if we say something against a journalist, you say my tribe. If you say, suppose, lawyer, then they say my. I think we need not be defensive. We are all sitting here because we are concerned. It's our future, more than my future, it's your future. So we need to have conversations. We need to question ourselves and our, the received wisdom, the kind of debates that we hear. And we do not have informed debates. So I think that that is the area where I think that speaking truth is. Speaking truth to power is not a question of speaking truth only to that, which is very important as well, but speaking truth to ourselves.
You know, Nandita, I'll take a question if you can get a mic, and I'll bring Harsh and you in again on this, because Harsh started that and he says there's been a failure of possibly a generation which is attuned to yours, that you've not been able, that thought has not permeated down. And that is why possibly, you know, there are a lot of people there who are clapping when this, you know, when the gentleman here was saying. So there are contrary views. So where is this, how is this failure come into, you know,
I don't think
what
we,
has happened?
I don't think we have failed because this is not a class in which you fail and pass. I think we belong to a generation which we, I'm very proud of my generation. I think we made lots of mistakes, but we fought. We made human rights an issue, which was never an issue. We made women's rights an issue, which was never an issue in this country. We are people who are still sitting here in our 60s and 70s and still alive and still fighting. We didn't give in to, you
why
know.
Why a disconnect? Why does a 25-year-old
disconnect is also
like
historically correct. His 25-year-old has a right to feel because he doesn't read my books and they make no sense to him because they are written in a context which doesn't exist. So I think
the context of, say, civil liberty, the context of what you stand for doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, because we began in 1975 when there was a national emergency. So when I speak in my class, in law class, and I said, you know, in the emergency, and they said, ma'am, we weren't born. So that is true because our context is different. After all, the world has completely changed. I never used the computer till 2001. We didn't have mobiles, they didn't have information, we didn't have an Edward Snow, we didn't have a Wikipedia. I don't think we failed. I just think that we are not able to cope with a totally different world. Mm-hmm. And that is a challenge for us. We are trying to struggle to cope.
So you're saying this new world has been fed, Harsh, on the information which is being generated of the current context, and that is what they're going by.
Well,
not to simplify
gone,
it,
huh?
The WhatsApp university or the other.
Yeah. I mean, like... like Nandita, I am proud of our generation and what it stood for, but I do think we have failed. I think we have failed profoundly to capture the imagination of the India which is below 25 years. I think that we took the Constitution and what it stood for granted. We took for granted that this will always be a country where hate will never gain ascendancy, where all of us will, it'll be a caring, it'll be a just society. We will have failures, but we will,
right,
that the majority of us will stand on the side of justice. Today, not just in India, but all around the world, we are seeing us, it has become, you know, to be a minority anywhere in the world today has become extremely dangerous. And we need to understand why. We also, have governments which are doing less and less for the poor, and I think that the, you know, whatever years I have left, battling the state is no longer important for me. Battling us, the problem is not out there. We are electing leaders which reflect our aspirations, and I think that our aspirations, where have we lost our compassion? Where have we lost our sense of solidarity and fraternity? Where have we lost our sense of justice for all? You know, Martin Luther King said that the arc of history is long, but it bends towards justice. How long will it take till it bends towards justice? Hunger, you know, every third child in India is malnourished. We have so much wealth today. We have, yeah, and it doesn't seem to cause any outrage. So I think that as a society, we need, those of us in the older generation, need to inspire young people with the belief of a compassionate and just society, which we have not done adequately.
You know, what I'm going to do is, in the last 10 minutes, I'm going to move on to, so we've discussed the current context, we've discussed why it's happening, we'll hopefully now touch on what can be done moving ahead, but yes, you wanted to get
exactly
away.
My point is, what can be done? So I'm asking a solution on something which you mentioned. So when we are saying that we are speaking truth through power, so someone needs a language to speak truth through power, right? So how do we determine, and how do we inculcate, and how do we, you know, manufacture those people who can speak when we have a certain language, let's call it like English, which is, there's a hegemony of that language in the knowledge production part, and that imagination which you're talking about is not translated to the people down the line.
You know, Kanak, I'll get you in on this, and you know, the question I want to also put forth is, because you know you're from Nepal, you view us from, you know, in that context, is you know, we have an RTI which has been diluted, we have the Whistleblowers Act which still hasn't passed. So, you know, Harsh said that, you know, people distance themselves from him, and it's Harsh Mander. What about, the common man? What about, or anybody who wants to speak truth to power? There is no mechanism to support that in this country yet.
I feel the available tools are essentially being utilized by the right wing, the newly available tools. Because what is it that intimidates the opinion maker? Or because I would not talk for now about the common man and woman on the street, because the speaking truth to the power is actually the role of what you call civil society, opinion makers, journalists, and others. And so, what has traditionally challenged them? It is militarism. And all of our countries, including India, is actually in the swamp of militarism. Let me make that point, including Nepal. Then you have the autocrat. Then you got the business interests. Then you got what you call majoritarianism or radical populism. And all of this is being supported by social media as we know it thus far. Because in my personal analysis, if you look overseas, it is the right wing that has taken advantage of social media, especially Facebook and others, from Bolsonaro to Putin to Duterte to Trump, and then closer to home amidst all of us, it is the right wing. So this is the new tool that is reason there is a kind of a sense of trolling that is pervading all of us, all our opinion makers, and they keep quiet. So I would say we need to utilize the, as I said again earlier, the vernacular, which is essentially being hijacked by one side, has got to be now picked up by the other side. Because I don't think there is an isolation of the right wing when it comes to social media. In fact, they run the show.
What is the other side?
The other side would be people who I consider myself, if you will, the left liberal broad spectrum person, right? Whereas the right wing for me is, in the context of India, it would be Hindutva. In the context of Nepal, it would be the royalists. In the context of Pakistan, it would be the Jamaat. In the context of Bangladesh, likewise. In the context of Sri Lanka, it would be the Sinhala nationalism, which right now is suddenly coming forward, what is known as hyper-religious nationalism that is being propelled right now by Gotabaya Rajapakse, who may just win the elections. So everybody is in the pot together, and we must recognize how do we, not with a campaign, but utilizing the tools available to us, I think that's the way to go.
Liberal has come to be a highly maligned word, but Nandita wanted to come in.
I think on the issue of social media, I've really been thinking that why is it that we are not able to use it? And part of the answer is...
You're not on Twitter. I was trying to find
you. Yeah, I am not. Okay, I want to answer why I'm not. When I finished the Kashmir case, suddenly I found my Facebook account opened by someone else. I also found a whole lot of bearded men who became my friends. I did not know what to do. I asked some friends and Jane, you please get rid of it. I don't know what they did. They got rid of it. If you open it account, that I have 500 friends on Facebook. It's not my account. It's a false account. And I can't get rid of it. When I contact Facebook, they say, you have to have your real account in order to show us this is a false account. Now, it is funny, but it isn't. So I can't, and so therefore, in certain contexts, I think it is, I've taken a decision not to be on the social media. But there's another reason. It's very simple, the kind of the rhetoric on the right. All this right, it's very simple. We want one country. Of course we want one country. Now you want to answer what kind of one country we want, you need a much more sophisticated way of answering. You need a whole book which nobody wants to read. So the social media is a instrument which is very difficult for people who want to put forward complex arguments, discussions, history. None of that can be done on a Twitter account. So I think that we have to think ways out. I do not know the answer to it. I don't know the answer to many questions. I can only pose more questions to you. But I think that that is a problem of using social media, because there are very many very interesting websites on the internet, but they won't reach anyone because they have very complex debates, their documentation, their archives, but they will not reach. And so social media is a child of an age to which I do not belong.
I can see how it's mobilized. I can see how the right wing mobilizes. I can see why some young people have these questions for us. But for every one question, I need an hour to answer. I cannot answer rhetorically.
All right, so what we're going to do is, you know, I'm running short of time, and I just want to, at the back of this conversation, before it, I want to ask how many of you think we've actually lost the ability to speak truth to power in this audience, you know, because, all right. And how many of you think that this is a propaganda run by Latins media or anti-nationals? All right, okay, so there's hope.
There's still hope. But can I, you know, I just wanted to respond to the idea of what do we do about it, because it's no, there's no point in lamenting and walking away. I'm very convinced that we have to find a different way of resistance. You cannot fight hate by hate. I mean, I have my hate and you have your hate and we fight each other. And so if there's complete darkness in this space and we say, I want to fight this darkness, so in my room also is lit, I'll put that also off. It'll only get more dark. We have to find ways of fighting hate with what I call radical love. And that is through all of this, we have to say, no, I don't go along with this idea that I can only prove I love my country by hating other countries. I can love my country and still respect the right of Pakistan and every other country to live. I love my country, my religion, only by hating other religions. No, I love my religion, and my loving my religion teaches me that I have to love people of every other religion and respect them. I think we have to fight in a very different kind of way. So we decided that we would take a journey across the country called Karwan-e-Mohabbat. We've done 31 journeys. We've gone to every family affected by lynching to say that there are people who care. We stand together. I feel ashamed for what your country has become. I think that there's an, you know, I just want to say, then this is not something new. Think of India as also a country of Nanak, of Kabir, of Akbar, of Ashok. We have traditions that we have to draw onto, and we have to excite our young people with a celebration of the idea of a caring and a compassionate society.
All right, I'm going to just take final words. And Kanak, would you want to come in? What's the way out?
I'd like to get to the question asked by the gentleman standing by the pillar at the back, who asked, where do you see this going? And I would suggest that if we are not careful, all over South Asia, Pakistan has its own problems. Sri Lanka, especially after the Easter Sunday bombings, has suddenly become a very, very scary place for people, citizens who look to the future when they thought they had turned the corner after the long war. Bangladesh is seen, especially because the Indian media mollycoddles Bangladesh, because it is supposed to be a friend of the current Indian government. Bangladesh, as I wrote in an article in The Hindu about a few months ago, Sheikh Hasina is riding a tiger. She cannot get off. But there is a very, very, there's great vulnerability and essentially arising out of a one-party state that Bangladesh has become. So for all its economic progress, there are great distress up ahead. So looking at it from all perspectives, so that you will not think that I'm only pointing at India, I would say that because India is so vast, and when something goes wrong in India, the result, the misery that that leads to is exponential. And nobody wants to say, okay, but it's not that bad. If it, the signs are things are bad. And so you need to do something about it. So I'd like to end by, Madam Moderator, by referring to something very personal. I was studying in the law faculty in Delhi University. I graduated 1975 to 77. And I'm in the same batch as the current Chief Justice of India. Ranjan Gogoi. What I remember was during the emergency, riding on the back of the Mudrika and realizing that people are not talking to each other. This is Mrs. Indira Gandhi's emergency. I believe that there is an undeclared sense of crisis in India. Why is it that journalists, till day before yesterday, were talking to each other on WhatsApp? Right? And why is it that myself in Nepal, when I was being targeted, I was on WhatsApp?
that the tools of the state and the tools of the ultra-populist sections of society is such that they can really come after you. There's a term that has entered the Nepali language. It's called setting. Setting has become a Nepali word. It may also be a Hindi and a Urdu word, where you get set up because anybody can find anything on you. And it's so easy now in the digital era to find the dope on you if they come out against you. So I believe that people are intimidated everywhere, and it can only because of the fears of what can happen in a large country like India if things go awry. It's time to start the counter moves, always with peace, with warmth in the heart.
Right, let's take the final comments there. But on a lighter note, Mr. Kanak, is your course mate delivering the Babri Masjid verdict before he retires?
I don't know, but I wish him all the best, and I wish India all the best.
All right, let's quickly close, and Nandita, we'll close then.
Well, whatever I've said, my analysis obviously sounds very pessimistic, and it is. But as an activist or as a person, I have always felt that we can always do something. And as I said, the Parliament attack case was the ultimate. It was an attack on Indian Parliament. It was a BJP government. It was BJP Union of Teachers Union. And yet we got this man acquitted. I think that's because I had a faith in a democratic space in India, a space which you cannot just access. You have to fight for it. And how did we do it? You're not allowed to put posters in Delhi. It's illegal. I personally put 5,000 posters along with some friends all over because no journalist would carry reports. So we put 5,000 posters in Urdu and Hindi all over on this issue, and we made we made people aware. What I'm trying to say is that there are many thousand things, and already this is not one. There were lots of people involved in this process. There were 4 or 5 universities involved. I don't think that there is, I don't think many young people or lots of young people support this lynching or this hate. They don't know what to do because there are no organizations. We need organizations. We need politics. We need more politics and better politics. And this shying away from politics and saying, oh, ye to political ho gaya. And every TV debate you'll say, ye to political ho gaya. What that anchor means is that it's become political parties. But we need a deeper political understanding of all this in order to fight it. And there are already thousands of people. In fact, in Kashmir in 1990, there were only 2 fact-finding. One was another one before me and one was after us. Today, lots of people, dozens of people have gone. But they all, lot of them write to me, some of these from Bhopal. They said, but we can go, but we don't know the history. We want to show solidarity. So I'm not saying that is enough. But there are many, many more people who are showing solidarity, and even the media is much better than 1990. So I think that there are thousands or lakhs of Indians who do not accept the kind of hate politics which is on. But we are not providing, whoever we are, an alternative. That alternative cannot be provided by any one of us. We can do many things. They can do padyatras like Sanjeev Pandeji is doing, or some other thing which Harsh Mandaji is doing. There can be children's books which are being written to counter it. There are 1,000 things being done in this country, but they are not coming to the fore because they are not organized. So we need more politics, better organization in order to fight what I hope we all agree is not a good thing for this country.
Well, let's raise a warm applause for our panelists. Thank you so much.